Hello and welcome to Miniatures Rundown. Today we're reviewing a different skirmish game from our usual Necromunda or Warhammer fare. It's Mutant Year Zero, Zone Wars.
Zone Wars.
So a little bit of history on this one. Mutant Year Zero is a tabletop RPG and also a video game. This is, I would say, more closely related to the video game, but it does have some tie-in with the tabletop RPG, if you're familiar with either of those. Mm-hmm. If you're familiar with the video game, Dux and Borman both show up in here. If you're familiar with the tabletop RPG, you can actually transfer characters from that to this using rule systems, which is very fun. But this is a skirmish game that we have our eyes on because it was designed in part by Andy Chambers of Necromunda and other Warhammer fame. And having played it, there's a lot of Necromunda in this.
Yeah, we did mention that, it seems it takes a lot of influence from each other. And in that, there's some Necromunda in this, and then there's some things they took from Necromunda and definitely fixed.
And made better, yeah. This is, our initial learning game took an hour and 20 minutes, and that was with lots of rules flipping. So, the game itself is 1 to 4 players. Mm-hmm. There is a solo mode. The starter box, this is weird off the bat, because there's this box, which is the Zone Wars box. And then there is a second box with two different teams in it, the Psychic Mutants and these robots. That one is not a starter kit by itself, and you need this box to play.
Yes.
But this one comes with two. You can play 1v1. Having played it, I think a 4-player game or a 3-player game would work quite well.
It would be very fun.
It would work very well in a way that it doesn't necessarily work in Necromunda.
Right.
We're going to be making a lot of Necromunda comparisons because that's the game we know. And also because it's the skirmish game we play.
Yeah.
It uses a D6 system. It does come with proprietary dice.
Yeah, quote unquote.
Which you'll see on the screen now. But very nicely, even though there are special symbols, they still put the numbers on the special symbols.
Yes.
So you don't have to have the proprietary dice for this. You can just use normal dice, which is fantastic.
It's like the old GW dice that have a symbol on the 1 and the 6, but it still also shows the 1 and the 6, unlike GW.
And unlike GW, it's very clear which one's the 1 and which one's the 6, not a skull and then a slightly different skull.
Yeah.
I hate GW dice. Anyway, it's 1 to 4 players. And the idea is, based on scenarios, you're hunting for artifacts. It's not just a kill each other game.
Mm-hmm.
It can be. But you're hunting for artifacts, and also the zone, which is post-apocalyptic, wherever you are, is trying to kill you.
Yes. So the main trying to kill you is Acid Rain, which was also the timer.
In the mission we played.
The mission we played, specifically.
The timer and the zone was Acid Rain.
Yes.
It rains!
It rains!
Everybody dies!
yeah. So everybody dies?
Basically, in addition, you build a deck of cards called your zone deck. And you draw one of those cards as part of the activation system, which we'll talk about. And in this case, that zone card could be something like Land Shark, which attacks you if you walk without rhythm, or rather, if you move too much. There was also summoned a giant razorback, which is a charging boar.
Mm-hmm.
The Ravenous Devourer, which was a honey badger or a bear that ate Mitchell Sniper.
Yep.
Or it triggered Acid Rain, which after that happened 4 times, everybody died and the game ended.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a mix of, there is combat. It's all based around D6 shooting. One thing I found super interesting is that all the combat and all of your successes on a D6 is only a 6.
Mm-hmm. So if you're only rolling 3 dice, you don't have a very high chance of getting a 6.
The way it influences how good you are at something is rolling more dice.
Right.
So this is not a Warhammer game in the sense of having a ballistic skill target. It's you will have a ballistic ranged attack of 5, so that means you roll 5 ranged dice, and you're just hunting for 6s.
Mm-hmm.
Which I is interesting, and it makes things less scary than they seem at glance.
I agree.
But things can also spike.
I agree.
Mr. Landshark does 8 attacks.
Yep.
And he whiffed 2 of them.
Which is, you know, likely. Likely would get like 1.33 or whatever. But it's possible he could just get like 4 damage and insta-kill a guy.
Yeah, or 8. The activation system, I guess we should talk about, is very interesting because it's not you go, I go. It's essentially the bolt action activation system.
I have not played bolt action, so I had to be told this by Josh.
So what this is each team has a token. You put a number of tokens equal to the number of models you have in a cup or a bag, and then you blind draw them. And whoever's you draw, you go. So you can draw your own faction four times in a row, mm-hmm. but then your opponent gets to go four times. Where this differs from Bolt Action is that, I should say where this differed from Bolt Action, because Bolt Action's getting a third edition and I have no idea if it's going to be the same.
Oh, yeah, fair.
I think it is, but I don't know. Is that the zone itself also gets tokens in there based on the number of players, mm-hmm. which means that you could draw and the zone goes. Mm-hmm. So that could be the zone monster appears or land shark or a sandstorm or
rain, or you find an artifact was one of them.
Yes. Yeah, we did not get that one. The one good one we did not get. The box also comes with cardboard terrain.
Yep.
Which is, it's fine.
Yeah, it wasn't a lot of terrain.
No.
And you definitely want to upgrade later if you end up playing more of this. But it was great for its starter box.
Yep, and very easily assembled and mm-hmm. disassembled. It also came with a paper mat 3x3. Again, it was fine. It is what it is.
Yeah.
You probably want to upgrade later to a nicer state. One thing we do really want to talk about being miniatures right now is the miniatures that come in this box.
Yes, definitely.
They're very nice.
They are. They are all come already built. I don't even think
I think they're single cast hard plastic.
Yeah.
Kind of CO casty feeling, but definitely more on the hard plastic side of things.
Yeah, they feel like the newer Reaper miniatures in that they're a little sturdier than a CO cast, I think. But the detail's great. They came sun-dropped. I'm sure you will have pictures.
Yes.
Cody will be editing pictures in. And they look great out of the box.
Yes. They're pretty good detail. The sun-dropping makes them stick out. We didn't feel the need to paint them. We will paint them.
Yeah.
Before our first game, they weren't just two teams of gray plastic or red plastic, blue plastic.
Mm-hmm.
I really like the miniatures a lot. That's actually what grabbed me for this box.
Mm-hmm.
It comes with 10 of them, 5 for each side. The other box also comes with 10 of them, 5 mm-hmm. for each side, I believe.
I believe you're correct.
The measuring system is also interesting. It uses inches. It gives you a short, medium, long ruler.
Mm-hmm.
And those are quantified. Short is 2.5 inches. Medium is 5 inches. Long is 10 inches. But it also gives you the inch measurements, so you can just use a tape measure.
Yeah. Kill team.
Yeah. And everything in the game is either short, medium, or long distance,
mm-hmm.
or unlimited distance in the case of some guns, which I do like.
Yeah.
I like that they're compromising in the way of using our proprietary stuff.
But also you can do this.
But you can just play at the darn game.
Yeah.
Like, I really like that. So the mission structure is, as you'll see, footage goes up here. You set up the terrain board. The way you set up the artifacts on the board was very fun. You have to stand 5 feet above the table and drop them.
And the way to distribute these artifacts is to hold them 5 feet above the table and drop them. Seriously. Oh my god. All right.
Is that for every game or is it just the first one?
I don't know.
I don't
but
know
that's
either.
A really silly way of doing it.
It is. And especially since we kind of had to fix it.
Yeah, and you have to kind of fix it. I'm not sure. It's a fun idea, but I'm not sure I love it.
So it said you drop them from 5 feet up mm-hmm. and then anything that's medium distance, so 5 inches from each other, you have to move and do again.
Yeah.
So we ended up, after two drops, just kind of moving them around. That was a little wonky. I kind of wish that it didn't have the you have to move stuff if you just like dropped them and that's where they were.
Maybe, but the random allocation on that first drop would not have been very, like...
No.
It would have just been a cluster truck in the middle, like...
Which is kind of what I like.
Yeah, that's
it'd
fair.
It would have been fun. We'd have had to go for it.
Yeah, that is fair. The soul of the game, in addition to the combat, is picking up these artifacts.
Yeah.
And the artifacts can be something like a baseball bat with spikes,
yep.
which gives you better melee attack, but can also be a clock.
Yeah.
A clock which... gave me a point for the scenario because you're trying to get these artifacts and get off the board.
Mm-hmm.
You're not just trying to kill the opponent. In fact, if you kill all the opponent but they got off the board with an artifact and you didn't, you lose.
Yeah.
But I found, for example, an alarm clock that I could either use as an artifact or use as a one-time weapon to throw at somebody.
Yeah, somehow in his... What would you pick up, four or three?
I picked up three artifacts. I picked up the hockey mask, which gave me armor,
yep.
which helped reduce damage from attacks. And I picked up a clock and an alarm clock.
Yeah, a wall clock and an alarm clock, both of which were basically the same thing.
They were exactly the same.
Yeah. So artifact relic is kind of a loose term here, but it's kind of fun.
That is a Mutant Year Zero thing,
yeah.
where in the they don't know what these things did. Because they're ancient relics,
mm-hmm.
so to them, you know, an alarm clock might be this special time teller thing that can control the time if you only had batteries, but you don't.
Yeah, don't have batteries anymore.
I looked ahead in through the deck. There's also things like teddy bears, laser pistols are in there.
Yeah, you can actually find useful things.
Yes, or you can keep finding alarm clocks.
Yeah, I swear we shuffled. But the, yeah, so the core was you get this equipment and it upgrades you throughout the game. And if you either take someone out in melee, you can immediately take a piece of equipment from them. Or if you shoot them, they can drop the equipment and you can go over and pick it up. Mm-hmm. Both of which are very interesting mechanics.
Yeah. So the other soul of Mutant Year Zero, both the RPG, the video game, and now this, is the idea that characters mutate. Mm-hmm. They get exposed to radiation and other things that mutate them. In the case of the robot faction, they can also have upgrade modules. There's a wonderful mechanic. When you roll dice, you're looking for sixes. But the one on your normal dice is a mutation token. And you can choose to, after you roll a dice, do a mechanic called pushing it, which is take all of your non-successes and all of your non-mutations and re-roll them.
Mm-hmm.
If you do that, all of the mutations you get are a mutation point that you can spend to activate the mutations that your characters have. The problem is if you do that with weapons or armor, it also can destroy your weapons or armor,
yeah,
reducing it in value and eventually just wrecking it and making it useless. But you can repair this stuff using a survival skill, which is one of your stats.
Mm-hmm. I honestly forgot that. We didn't even do it once.
None of our weapons ever broke until the very end,
yeah,
when poor Pharaoh's rifle broke in the face of a giant.
Yeah, facing off against a razor board.
And he had...
So I got one damage.
One damage, one mutation point, and damage to your weapon.
Yep, which Oof. Reduces it to nothing. So, and I have nothing that really helps with that. So he's dead.
And then the acid raid fell and killed everybody.
Killed him anyway.
The end. Yeah. Great way to go. Sorry, Mr. Fox. The unfantastic Mr. Fox. The survival skill in general is a big part of the game. It turned out to be way bigger than we thought.
Yeah, we were like, so you have melee and ranged and survival.
And
what
health.
The heck is survival?
This
and
is
health,
four
yeah.
Stats.
Yeah, four stats. And we were like, survival, I don't care about that. And it mattered a lot.
Yeah. So we both went with the like attack-heavy teams. And we spent most of the match not fighting each other, but just trying not to get killed by the zone.
Yeah, the stuff on the board and the acid rain and the landworms.
I think I did 2 damage to one of your guys.
Yeah, I believe so.
Most of my bullets bounced off of his diving helmet.
Yeah.
That sounds like a negative. And if you've listened to our Necromunda review, specifically of Ash Waste, we go on about that in a bad way.
Mm-hmm.
The difference is, number one, your survival skill gives everybody a chance to resist these things.
Mm-hmm.
And usually you only need one pass.
Right. It's just if you pass or fail.
Yeah. And you have guys with survival skills ranging from 2s to 5s.
Mm-hmm.
So you have a pretty decent chance to pass. And better, the thing I think that really makes this fighting the zone thing work is often a pass isn't just you aren't affected by it. It's you sick it on your opponent.
Mm-hmm. So survival is a huge part, a.k.a. the first activation.
Second activation. Because, no, Rabbit went first. Ruben
yep.
went first. My second activation, I drew a card on my guy who had a decent survival skill,
mm-hmm.
which was the Ravenous Devourer, which looks like a bear honey badger thing.
Yeah.
No, it's... Oh, that's a zone token. So, for zone tokens, we drew a zone token. What we do is we will randomly draw one of these. Now, a zone token always applies... Ravenous Devourer. Oh.
Basically, if I had failed, that token would have been in base-to-base contact with me and immediately attacked for a lot of damage. But if I pass, I get to put the token wherever I want, which means in contact with Mitchell's model. And I passed, which means that instead of like Necromunda, where the Ash Waste just either they kill you or they don't matter at all.
Yeah.
In this case, it was never a don't matter thing.
Yes.
It was either it killed you or it killed your opponent. Like, someone was getting messed up by this zone.
Yeah.
With some exceptions.
Sure.
I did have a card that let me ignore some of the negative effects on Moose. But otherwise...
Is that Moose's base mutation?
No, it was my second.
The randomized
mutation.
One? Okay.
You get a base mutation that's just part of your character's kit, and then you get a randomized mutation that can be anything from a venomous bite to a warning, like, dodge the survival yeah. thing to...
And it looks like, so far, it looks like each faction gets its own deck.
Yes.
Because there's psionic mutations, the... robot upgrades, and then physical is what I had, and feral is what you had. So everybody gets their own mutation deck.
Yeah. Which I like that a lot.
Yeah.
I like the push mechanic a lot in mm-hmm. the way that that's how you get these things to activate your special abilities, but it can also damage your equipment.
Mm-hmm.
It also means if you don't have any equipment, there's no punishment for doing it.
Yeah, you could just go for
and
it.
And the rules, in fact, tell you to do this.
There's no downside if you're not damaging equipment in the meantime.
Right, because you can't hurt your hands, I guess.
Yeah.
I quite like that a lot. Yeah, overall, I'm a big fan of the mechanics.
Yeah, I agree. After reading through the rules initially, I was a little skeptical with the, like, randomized who goes first and the only needing sixes, but in gameplay, it felt a lot better.
Yes. The only needing sixes, the amount of dice they give you is a nice balance between, oh, I threw a bunch of dice and nothing happened.
Yeah.
Because, like, that's the Dungeons & Dragons thing, right? Like, I need a 12. Most of the time, nothing happens.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, because of the number of the dice you're rolling, usually you get, like, one or two successes.
Yeah.
But not always. And something, even on a failure, something usually happens, mm-hmm. which is good. Because that's the problem with a lot of games where it's like, oh, you didn't pass, nothing happened.
Yeah.
In Necromunda, I shot at you, I missed, nothing happened.
Make an ammo check.
In this case, I can shoot at you, miss, and still get mutation points, or still break my gun.
Right, true.
I like that quite a bit. So that's gameplay. Let's talk about longevity. Like, is this a game that we'll keep coming back to?
So there is, between the different missions and the different mutations, there is some amount of replayability. And there are currently four factions.
Mm-hmm.
And I like it. I would definitely be willing to play it again. But it doesn't have quite the... Oh, and the artifacts, actually. It doesn't quite have, like, the Wargamer, like 40K or Necromunda, where it has the, like, the list building and all that stuff. And I particularly like list building.
Yeah, so it kind of doesn't have list building because usually you're going to bring all of your models, or at least most of them, in your faction. Now, it does have a couple of things in that regard. Number one, it's kind of unfair to compare it to Warhammer, right?
Warhammer is a
giant elephant and has 40 years of history or whatever.
But even to other skirmish games.
Yes. But there is something in here about creating your own characters
mm-hmm.
and using them. So there is probably some longevity to that. It talks about using your own miniatures for those characters.
Yep. I saw a campaign system and all that
stuff.
There
is a campaign system, and then there's a system for importing your characters to and from the tabletop RPG.
Mm-hmm.
So I think this will have more longevity to it if you engage with the other systems.
That's fair.
Or want to play those. Out of the box, there unfortunately aren't too many scenarios.
Yeah, there's like four?
There are five scenarios.
Five scenarios.
Which is not a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But I figure between the different mutations at play, the different zone shenanigans at play, and the different artifacts at play, each of those is going to be a fairly different mission.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there's more to it than just a couple games, but this probably isn't going to be a game you mainline.
Yeah, I agree. It would be like a side game. Hey, I haven't played that in a while. You want
to
break
like
it out?
Yeah, I plan to play it again, but it's probably not something you're going to play like every week for it. You know, you're probably not going to start a Mutant Year Zero night
right.
at your local gaming club.
I see this closer to a board game than a, like, full-on miniatures game.
Yes.
Because of that. It has some randomization. It has some list building. Like, we had three guys, like Josh mentioned, and we could have chosen our three guys. But there's only five guys in the faction. You could have taken all five. Whereas a miniatures game has, you know, 14 models to choose from. You get five of them or whatever. Like I said, this leans a little more towards the board game side of busting it out every once in a while mm-hmm. kind of thing.
Yeah, I still and not board game the side in the sense of it's like board gamey because it's not. It's very miniatures.
No, no, it's very miniatures gamey.
Yeah, there's almost no board game to it. But in the sense of you probably don't play this all the time.
Yeah.
But I think there's still a lot more to it, especially if you have the expansions.
Mm-hmm.
I also think that multiplayer games.
Yeah,
or where this would really shine.
I agree.
Four people trying to all get those artifacts.
Would be awesome.
Because you don't increase the number of artifacts for more people.
Right.
I noticed. And there's more zone shenanigans that happen with more people.
True.
And then, yeah, instead of... I think that's probably where this game is really going to shine.
Yeah, because we were on the verge of, like, well, I could activate my whole crew, and then you could activate your whole crew, but with four people on the board...
That becomes very unlikely.
It could be me, and then Cody, and then you, and then me again, and then you again...
Yeah.
It's nuts. Oh, and the scenario in the middle
of
there.
Yeah, and then out of nowhere, land shark.
Yeah, this sounds hilarious to play with four players.
Yeah, which I like. So, and I think it has a strong narrative component in that regard.
Yeah.
Overall, I'm going to give this a pretty good thumbs up for
me. Yeah,
I
agree.
I like this game. I'm going to get the expansion, and I hope we'll play that.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, but that's the thing is, like, do I want to play the robots, or do I want to play those, you know, moose again?
Yeah,
that was
the animals.
Or do I want to play the mutants? Because Diver Dan
yeah,
seems also pretty fun.
Diver Dan was pretty cool.
Denko, the diver man, who has a armored diving helmet, and is very good at not getting killed by land sharks.
He was. He had a ridiculous survival. He was survival 5.
Yeah, yeah.
Whereas, what's his name? Hugest.
Hugest. It's either Hugest or Hugest. Yeah. I think it's Hugest.
It's spelled like August, but instead of an A, it has an H. So we said, I said Hugest most of the time. He had a survival of 2.
But a really big melee weapon.
But he had a chainsaw. He started with a chainsaw.
And 5 attacks. Yeah. Like,
he was a melee monster, but, you know, he...
But he was no match for the land shark.
He was no match for the land shark. He was a match for the honey badger.
Yes.
Unfortunately, the guy with the fly wings, who didn't stay on the board long enough for me to care about his name, was not a match for the honey badger.
He got badgered immediately. Yeah. Almost like I did that on purpose.
Almost.
Although we did mess up the rules there. I'm sure we messed up a few rules.
Yeah.
And we'll get better at it as you play. The rules are pretty simple.
Yeah.
So
I'm gonna like we said, it was only an hour and a half first. A learning game.
Yeah, with 2 players, you could really crank through the games on this one.
Yeah.
So, overall, my impression's pretty positive.
Yeah, I agree.
I want to play this again. I want to paint these minis.
Yeah, oh yeah. Especially with the sun drop, they'd be probably pretty easy to paint, too.
Probably, yeah. And I want to get the expansions.
Yeah.
So,
I agree.
If you're looking for a post-apocalyptic game with some interesting characters, or if you're a fan of Mutant Year Zero, check it out.
Yeah. I have never heard of the games, and now I'm thinking about looking them up. In the RPG too,
yeah. The tabletop or the game's on Steam, mm-hmm. and it's pretty old, so it goes it's not super old, but a few years old.
Mm-hmm.
So it goes on sale for pretty cheap every now and then.
Gotcha.
I'll probably download it and play it when I get some time.
There you
go. Because this has piqued my interest, and I can hear Dux's voice in my head. All right, so that's it for this review. I almost said Necromundown review. It's not. It's a miniatures rundown review. We'll be covering other miniatures games. I think the next one up on the list, we might talk about Blackout,
mm-hmm.
And some other ones upcoming. Stay tuned, and we'll see you next time.
Bye.